at verse number 32. And I want to stop at verse 39. Although I could go into 40, but for the sake of what I really want to say tonight and need to say, I'm going to stop at 39. Is that all right?
Amen.
Y'all with me tonight? I can't hear anybody. I can't hear a talk back, church. Okay. All right. Hebrews 11 chapter, verse number 32. It says, what shall I more say? For the time would fail me to tell of Gideon and Barak, and of Samson and Jephthah, of David also and Samuel and of the prophets, who through faith subdued kingdoms, wrought righteousness, obtained promises, stopped the mouth of lions, quenched the violence of fire, escaped the edge of the sword. Lord Jesus, they escaped the edge of the sword. Out of weakness were made strong. They waxed valiant in the fight. Turned to flight the armies of the aliens. Women received their dead raised to life. And others were tortured, not accepting deliverance, that they might obtain a better resurrection. And others had trial of cruel mockings and scourging, yea, moreover, of bonds and imprisonment. They were stoned. Did y'all hear what I said? They were stoned. They were sawn asunder. They were tempted. They were slain with the sword. They wandered about in sheepskin and goatskin, being destitute, afflicted, tormented. But listen to this. Of whom the world was not worthy. Of whom the world was not worthy. They wandered in deserts and in mountains and in dens and caves of the earth. And these all having a good report through faith received not the promise. On your way down, I'm going to give you the title to my hard word tonight. What if he doesn't do it? Would you repeat that to somebody on your way down and say, hey neighbor? Y'all too quiet. I need to talk. I need to hear y'all tonight. I said, repeat to your neighbor, what if he doesn't do it? You can be seated in the presence of the Lord.
Hallelujah.
There was a college student. Now, y'all just flow with me for a minute. I'm going to taxi down this runway just a minute, all right? There was a college student, and he was in a class, and he had to do a report. And it was a presentation that he had to do that required him to use some kind of demonstration. And so he chose something called the law of the pendulum. Somebody say pendulum. And so what he did, ladies and gentlemen, is he went to the board and he drew the path of a pendulum. Everybody, we know what a pendulum is, right? Something, you know, it swings. Y'all with me? So he drew the path of the pendulum and he started on the board up here and talked about how the pendulum would swing out when he released it. Go to another point on the other side.
Come on. Yeah.
It would come to a stop and swing back in the other direction. But the point that he made, Pastor James, he said, I need you all to understand within the law of the pendulum will never go back as high as the place where it started. So if I release it from here, no matter what I do, when I release it, when it comes back, it's not going to come back at the level where it started. Now, he mentioned the force of gravity and all the other forces that would work against it. And he said, when he got done with this, y'all, he asked the question of his class. He said, classmates, how many of you all believe the law of the pendulum? He said, let me see the hands of all of you who believe in the law of the pendulum. And so, ladies and gentlemen, the whole class threw their hands up in the air. They all believed in the law of what?
The pendulum.
The pendulum. So he said, let me test this belief. He had somebody go out into the hallway and they rolled in this big contraption. This big contraption had, it was strung up on some ends, on the rollers, whatever. And it had a bowling ball on some ropes. And so he asked his professor to come, and he had a ladder on this side facing the contraption. And so he asked the professor to come and stand at the top of the ladder. And the professor came, stood at the top of the ladder, and he pulled the bowling ball over and up to where the professor was standing. Put the bowling ball right there by the professor's face. And he said, Professor, in just a moment, I'm going to release the bowling ball. And he asked the question again, how many of you in this class believe in the law of the pendulum? Y'all, you remember what the law of the pendulum is, right? The law of the pendulum was, if it goes out, it's going to swing up, but it will not come back as high as it was released. So he says to the professor, he asked everybody in the class, do y'all believe it? Everybody said, yes, we believe it. He asked the professor, Professor, do you believe in the law of the pendulum? The professor said, yes, I believe in the law of the pendulum. He says, I'm about to release this bowling ball. I need to make sure you believe in the law of the pendulum. Ladies and gentlemen, he released the bowling ball. And true to what the pendulum law said, out went the bowling ball. This thing was about 14, 15 pounds. And he had released it from the face level of the professor. When the thing swung out, it got to the other end. And when it got to the other end, saints of God, it began to make its journey back toward the professor. Moments before the professor, the ball reached the professor, he jumped down off the ladder, moved back away from where he was. And the student said, I see what just happened. He said, you believed it in theory, but not in reality.
Amen.
That's good. Come on.
What did you take all that time, Dr. Long, telling that story for? Because I've been in church a long time. And if I ask the question in the church, how many of you believe God is a miracle working God? I guarantee you the hands of almost every person in this room would fly up in the air. They'd say, I believe that God is a miracle working God. Am I talking right up in here? If I asked you if God was a healer, believe that God is a healer. Let me see the hands of you that believe that God is a way maker. Let me see the hands of you that believe that God is a door opener. Let me see the hands of you that believe that he'll deliver you out of trouble. So why is it that when real trouble comes, what we say we believe, we believe it in theory. We believe it in theory, but we don't believe it in reality. Am I talking up in here already? I said we believe it in theory, but we don't believe it in reality. And so now we struggle in our hearts because when trouble comes, when hardship comes, we have difficulty believing in reality. Because if you believed it in reality, you'd be steadfast. I can't get a talk back, church, right there. You'd be unmovable. Just because your grandson has not gotten saved yet, you won't be up here at the altar crying, acting like God didn't hear your prayer when your grandson's still out there on drugs. I need a church right there. Because your brother or your sister is still strung out, you won't be up here crying with defeat, saying, "Oh God, I'm so scared he's going to die." There will be a confidence. That's it. There is a confidence that comes when you really believe it in reality. Can I preach like I feel it tonight? I need you to understand, ladies and gentlemen, that when you believe it in reality, it will cause you to stand against the odds. It'll cause you to hold on when nothing else seems to work. It'll cause you to not give up. It'll cause you to keep the faith. It'll cause you to stand even though it hurts. When you believe it in reality, when the electric bill is due and you don't know what you're gonna do, you're not gonna be around there struggling and crying, and your co-workers looking at you wondering, do you really believe this God you say you serve? Because your countenance is so down, your heart is so heavy, you can't even go to work and work well because you got so much on you. I'm trying to talk to somebody. You believe it in theory, but it's time for you to start believing it in reality. How do I start to believe it in reality? I'm coming to tell you, faith is brought about by your experience. I said your faith is brought about by your experience. I put it to you like this. If I never had a problem, I would never know God's ability to solve problems. Some people believe that we're supposed to live on flower beds of ease, that everything's supposed to be easy and wonderful, but sometimes you need a little hardship in your life. You need a little trouble to come. If you never had trouble, you never trust God. Let me preach too hard, too fast. If you never had problems, let me do it like this. Bible says, man born of a woman is on a few days. And the few days that we're here, the book says, now y'all tell me in my mind, I think I read it in the book. The book says, those born of the few days, and they are full of trouble. Why are you getting so bent out of shape? Because your days have been full of trouble. The Bible did not say that few are the afflictions of the righteous. I need to talk that church right there. I said the Bible did not say that few are the afflictions of the righteous. No, the Bible said many are, oh God, many are the afflictions of the righteous. So why I wish I had a talk back church right there.
Come on.
Yeah, why are you so shocked and beaten down when trouble seems to keep coming your way?
Come on.
Why are you so troubled and beat down when hardship keeps coming? Why are you so wiped out because trouble keeps hitting your house? Seem like the house over there, they got everything going good, but in your house, if it ain't one thing, it's another. Am I talking to anybody up in here? Joneses seem to have everything good. Why do the Smiths seem to have everything wonderful? And over here, seems like every time I turn around, I got to visit the hospital to see somebody.
Come on.
Gotta decide whether I'm going to take Mama or Papa to the nursing home. Oh, y'all not talking up in here. I got to make decisions about life that I didn't think I was going to have to make because the preacher told me that when I got saved, everything was going to be all right. I come to tell you that just because you gave your life to Jesus does not mean that everything is going to always be all right. But I do have good gospel news for you. Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord church has taught us how to cover it up and act like things are well, because if you act like things aren't well, then that must mean you don't have faith. But can I talk about the book of Hebrews chapter 11? I'm sorry, I just feel like I feel like preaching tonight. Hebrews chapter 11 talks about the people of the faith. We call it the hall of fame of faith, if you will. Ladies and gentlemen, understand that in the hall of fame of faith, there was a man by the name of Abraham that promised Abraham that he was going to have a baby boy. And the Bible says it was 25 years between the time that Abraham got the promise and the time that the promise was delivered. I got a question for you. How many of you can come to church, get a word from God, and then have to wait 25 years to see it manifest and not give up and not throw in the towel and not walk away and not say it was a false prophet that gave you the word? Some promises are going to take some time. Some promises are time to be incubated. Some promises you got to get ready for the impact. Some promises they got to get ready for you. For whatever the reason. Yeah. So somebody around you and say, could you wait 25 years to get a miracle? Could you wait 25 years to get your healing? Could you wait 25 years for your marriage to be restored? Could you wait?
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Oh God, I feel it here today. How many of you could wait 25 years? But now, it will be different if Abraham waited all 25 and never got weary. Am I talking to somebody in here? Say, he didn't wait all 25 and not get weary. The Bible declares that after about 11 years, Sarah told Abraham, go get my handmaiden Hagar, and we're going to make this thing happen our way. I don't know who I'm talking to tonight, but God told me to tell somebody, you can try and make it happen your way if you want to. You're going to make a mess out of your situation. Stop trying to help God out and let God be God. If God said it. God said it, it's settled. God have mercy. I wish I had a church to believe that today. Somebody help me with the children. If God said it, it is settled. Now, y'all be seated for a minute. Y'all be seated for a minute. Listen. So, just because you have faith doesn't mean you're not going to be challenged in your faith. It does not mean that you're not going to have low times where your faith begins to shake a little bit. I can't get a church right there. See, everybody wants to act like we're super spiritual, everything's going to be all right. No, I'm talking to the saints now that can admit and be honest that you know you got a word from God, but yet sometimes your faith is a little shaky. God, it does not look like. Has anybody ever been in a position where it looked like it was getting worse? You came to the altar, and the prophet stood at the altar and prophesied to you about your situation and told you that God was going to turn it around. And then, by the time he prophesied it, you walked out the door and got a text message that things had already turned and gotten worse rather than better. I don't know about you, but that's enough to make anybody's face shake. But you know, I'm grateful for the Bible. We try to look at the Bible through rosy-colored glasses, but I come to tell you that none of these characters were Jesus.
That's right.
None of these characters in Hebrews 11 were Jesus. Which means they had ups and they had downs. And I hear the Lord saying, he said, tell my people that the enemy has been lying to some of you that because you had a moment where your faith got shaken, that he tried to tell you that you don't really believe God.
Come on.
Maybe that was just for one person, but that's all right. I said he's been trying to tell some of you that because you had a shaky moment in your faith, you must not believe God. You must not have the faith you say you have. But that's a lie. Because God, my joke said like this, he knows my frame. He knows how he made me. He knows my inner working. He knows what hurts me. He knows what will make me shake. But he also knows, just like he did with Job. He said, go ahead, devil. I should have had about three people to holler right there. I said, he knows so much about me that he knows so much about what he put in you. He knows so much about what he's invested in you that when the devil comes and says, let me hit her in this area, let me hit her finances, let me hit his family, let me hit his children, let me hit the church, he knows that when he says that, and God says, go ahead.
Hallelujah.
Sit down. He knows that when it's all said and done, you may have a moment. Oh, Jesus.
Come on.
Lord have mercy. He knows you may have a moment where, watch this, y'all. We quote this all the time, but we don't pay attention to the fact that Job's judgment got off when the pressure got hit.
Come on.
I don't have to talk that church yet. I said, Job's judgment got off when the pressure got heavy. We quote it all the time. We say, though he slay me, yet will I trust him. Am I in the Bible, y'all? Oh, I don't have a three Bible readers for me. Let me find out. Has anybody heard that the Bible says, though he slay me, yet will I trust him? for permission to hit Job. Hello?
Enemy.
Who was it that asked God for permission to touch Job? God said, Satan, go ahead. Satan went his children, killed them off, caused somebody to come in and take all of his livestock. He lost everything that he had. Now here's my question. Who was slaying Job? Was it God or was it Satan? Hello? But yet under, I'm trying to help somebody right here. Yet when he was under so much pressure, when the pain was heavy, when things were at their greatest amount of pressure, he did not say, though Satan slay me.
Right. Come on.
Huh? He said, though, yes, he, watch this. Sometimes you can get in a position where there's so much pressure on you and so much frustration on your life, it will cause you to get in a place where you misconstrue what's going on. You'll start to think that God is doing something that is not really God doing. You'll start to think that God is causing these problems. God is not the source of your problems.
Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah.
Come on.
I don't have time. I can just jump to the end and tell y'all, if the truth be told, God didn't let Satan in on a secret. He had a plan to bless Job double all the way from the beginning. From the moment you came in my face talking about you wanted to hit it, I had a plan in my head that I was going to bless Job double all he had. I was going to take him higher than he's ever been before. But I had to let you hit him in order for him to be able to be elevated to the higher place. Somebody in here ought to get a revelation that God will let the devil hit you so you can go to a higher place. It's okay as long as the pain comes from somewhere else. But when the pain comes from the folk that sit on the pew next to you.
Yeah.
I thought they loved God like I love God. And you mean to tell me that they talk about me, they lie on me, they gossip on me. You mean to tell me that because they don't understand what's going on in my life, they have the room to talk about what God's doing because they feel like I'm not making as much progress as they think I ought to make and move as fast as they think I ought to. You mean to tell me that they don't talk about me? Folk get up and they walk out of church and never come back. I'm going to shift gears now. These people had the kind of faith that allowed them to be cut in half. They had the kind of faith. They didn't care if they drove a sword through them. They didn't care if they were persecuted. They said, I love God enough. I'm willing to die. Sadly, please don't get distracted, saints. I need y'all to hear this word. Sadly, we don't have very many believers who have that level of faith now. This is where I got to work my way through because, ladies and gentlemen, we don't have that kind of faith now. We don't have people who have, watch this, because that kind of faith comes from relationship. See, this is where I'm going to get in trouble. This thing right here. This is where I'm going to get in trouble.
Come on, preach.
Because that kind of faith comes from relationship. And most of us are too busy to cultivate a relationship.
Amen. There it is. That's it.
Amen.
Amen.
We spend more time on Facebook.
Come on.
Than we do in our Bibles.
Amen.
Okay. Some of y'all say, I don't go on Facebook. He's not talking to me. You spend more time in front of your television.
Come on.
Than you do in your Bible. You spend more time on the phone with friends.
Amen.
Than you do talking to God.
Come on, preach this thing.
Yes.
The faith that I'm talking about comes from experience.
Yes.
It comes when you say, I'm not going anywhere. Now, you can't say, I'm not going anywhere unless you trust the one with whom you're in relationship. I can't even talk that term. Don't y'all know what I'm talking about? When you trust the one you're in relationship with, you will stand up boldly and say, this one right here belongs to me, and I belong to him, and I ain't no.
Come on.
Because you got experience with this one. Because you got experience with them. Over time, you develop a trust in them that says, I'm not going anywhere because they're not going to leave me.
Hallelujah.
I feel like running down this aisle when I say this right here. I come to tell you that even in marriage, sometimes the folks that say they won't leave will leave. But I got a promise from somebody who said, no, I'll never leave you, nor will I forsake you. He said, I'll be with you always, even until the end. What are you trying to say? No, you can trust your God. Trust him.
Amen.
You can trust him.
Trust him, yes.
You can trust him.
Amen.
You can trust him. Amen. Why do you keep repeating? Because I need to get down in your belly. You can trust him.
Yeah. Oh.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Glory.
Yeah. Yes, Lord.
Yeah.
I can trust it.
Amen.
Even when I don't understand what he's doing.
Come on. Yes.
I can still trust him.
Oh, yeah. Come on.
Even though I'm hurting on the inside. Because when it's time to leave, I shall come forth.
Come on.
I wish I had about five people to know the text. He said, and when he is trying me, I shall come forth. I stole. Try me in the fire. Take me through the hell. Take me through the pain. When I go through, I can say, when you try me, you're going to bring me out. I told you the topic of my message today was what if? Somebody out here, God should tell you, stop laying there. The roads have already been burned.
Yeah. Come on. Woo. Come on.
I'm prophesying to somebody in here. I said, God said, quit laying there. Quit wallowing in your pity. Quit wallowing in your past. Quit wallowing in what happened. Get up from there. The roads have already burned off. The fire burned them off. But you've been set free. Say yes.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Oh. Hallelujah.
They had the kind of faith that said, even if he doesn't do it, I still trust him.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Can I walk through one more text? There was a man by the name of John the Baptist.
Woo! Yes, Lord.
He was a baby, an embryo in his mother's womb. The Bible declares, Lord, the Bible declares that when Mary met Elizabeth, it said when she met her and she spoke to her, said that the baby child leaped in his mother's womb. The Bible declares that John the Baptist was full of the Holy Ghost from his mother's womb. The Bible declares that John was in the Jordan River baptizing folks. And while he was baptizing, he looked up on the hill. And coming down the hill, if you will, there was somebody that was his cousin. Coming down the hill, he said, behold. Y'all remember the Bible, don't you? Behold the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world. Jesus was the Savior. At least not this recorded in the scriptures that we know of. But somehow he knew that that was the Messiah.
Amen.
Then the Bible says that John was in the water and Jesus said, I must be baptized by you, John. John said, no, you need to be baptized in me. He said, no, you got to baptize me so the scriptures can be fulfilled. And the Bible said that then John baptized Jesus. And when he took him down in the water, when he came up. Y'all want to help me preach over here. When he came up out the water, the Bible said the heavens opened and they all saw it. The heavens opened and a voice spoke. The heavens open and they're descended on Jesus. Oh my God. They're descended on him. The Holy Ghost in the form of a dove. John was standing there and John saw it.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
He didn't just see it. He heard it. He heard God say, this is my beloved Son. That's what he said. John saw it. John heard it. God affirmed it. But there came a day. go find Jesus. Go search him out. And when you find him, I wish I had all three people to help me preach it here. And when you find Jesus, go ask him, are you the one? Or should we seek for another? What you saying, Mom? The same John that leaped in his mother's womb. The same John that didn't have anybody tell him that Jesus was the Lamb of God to take away the sins of the world. The same John that saw the dove. The same John that heard the voice. Got under so much pressure. He said, are you the one? So y'all, the devil trying to make you question, did you make the right decision when you walked down the aisle and gave Jesus your life? Does it seem like from the moment you gave Jesus your life, it seems like you've been through more hell than you've ever been through before? Seems like you've been through more problems than you've ever suffered before? Seems like it's gotten easier, it's gotten harder. But I come to tell you, God was in the prison. He said, are you the one? Or should we seek for another? Jesus said, tell him the dead are being raised. Tell him blinded eyes are being opened. Tell him the lame are walking. Tell him everything's all right. But now I got a question. This is where I want to hang my hat tonight. Surely, if Jesus was going to deliver anybody, John was his cousin. He knew John was in prison. Surely, if he was going to bring anybody out, shouldn't he bring John out?
Yeah. Y'all quiet. When you think if he's going to deliver anybody, brother, wouldn't he be delivering his own? Wouldn't you deliver your cousin out of prison if you could?
If I could.
And you know he didn't do anything wrong?
Amen.
You get out!
Amen.
How many of y'all in here, if it was your cousin in prison, you know he didn't do anything wrong? All he did was stand for the truth. And you had the ability to get him out. You can get him out.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Let me see. Would you get out? Well, we have no explanation on an earthly side. But the Bible said that when the young girl went and danced before the king, he said, tell me what you want. She went and talked to her heathen mama. And her mama said, give me John the Baptist's head on a platter. And the Bible says that the king had to honor his word. John the Baptist lost his head. See, we don't like to preach stuff like this. Because we love to hear the messages that say God's going to bring you out of the trouble. I can't get the church right there. We like to hear the messages that say God's going to bring you out of your trouble. And things are going to get better. But then we have stories like John the Baptist. Who we think should have been delivered. Yeah. It was his cousin. But now, he's beheaded. Why did you go through all of that, Dr. Long? I went through that because the Lord said something to me the other day in my closing. He said, son, we do the people of God a disservice when we don't prepare them for the moments when I say no. People have heard so many messages on God's ability, on God's power, and how God is a mighty, mighty deliverer. Self-possessed. We've heard all those. You know, are y'all with me? Have y'all heard some of those messages? Have y'all heard a lot of those messages?
Amen.
But I'm willing to bet
the farm. I don't have one, but I'm going to bet it anyway. But I'm willing to bet, y'all, that you haven't heard too many messages telling you that sometimes God ain't going to do it. Yes, you believe for healing. But what about stories like the prophet Elisha, who the Bible says, and Elisha was sick of the sickness by which he died. I mean, it's in the book. I mean, see, we like to gloss over those texts and act like they're not there. Now, here's Hezekiah, who had a sickness that was unto death. Y'all remember Hezekiah? King Hezekiah, the prophet walked in the room and said, Hezekiah, set your house in order. You're going to die.
Amen.
Hezekiah turned his face to the wall and prayed and reminded God of all the things that he had done. And the Bible said that God, before the prophet could even get out of the courts, sent him back and said, go tell Hezekiah, I've given him 15 more years to live.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Hmm?
Come on.
You got Hezekiah who gets 15 more years. But the prophet Elisha had a sickness by which he died. Now I have to be careful as I deliver this last portion of my message tonight, because it would almost make you not want to believe God anymore. But that's not my goal. Here's what the Spirit of God said to me. And I need everybody to pay attention to what I'm about to say. John chapter 6, verse 26. Let me give you the quick background of it. I need to hear you say, give me some prophetic flow. The Bible said that after Jesus had done a miracle, he sent his disciples over to the other side of the ship. Y'all know the story that while they were out there toiling and rowing, in the middle of the night, Jesus walks out on the water and goes out to where they are. And so, the next morning, all the people get up. They go looking for Jesus. They know there was only one boat. They know he didn't leave with them. So when they did not find him on that side, they went over. They found the ships and went over to the other side, looking for Jesus. Here's the problem. Pay attention right here. Jesus made a statement to them. He said, you didn't come seeking me because of the signs and the miracles. He said, you came seeking me because I broke bread and gave it to you and you were filled. The Lord said to me that what has happened in the body of Christ, and even in this room right now, we serve him, if you will, for the fishes and the loaves. But we're not really seeking him for who he is. I told you it was going to be hard. We serve him for what he can do for us. Am I making sense to anybody right now? This generation, baby, your generation is in church. As long as we keep preaching to you about how God wants to bless you, as long as we keep preaching to you about how God loves you and wants to bless you, we'll pack out our church. People will keep coming. They'll fill the church up. Because they want fishes. As you will. I know that's not good English, but they want the fish. And they want the loaves. They want God's hand. But they don't want his face. What happened? If the thing you've been believing for God decides to say no. What if you're like John the Baptist and you think you ought to be brought out? And God lets you stay in.
Going home.
What are you saying, Mom? You have not really committed yourself to Jesus until you're serving Him and trusting Him. Whether the answer is yes or the answer is no.
Man.
Don't tell me you love Him when times are good. Let me see how much you trust Him when the last thing that you were expecting to happen didn't happen. When you had the prayer chain for Mama, she's laying up in the hospital. You got everybody all across the country praying for Mama. Praying for your mama. Praying for your daddy. Praying for your baby. You look on social media and you see people like John Carter, who God gives his baby a miracle. I remember Pastor James being with John the night they brought the baby down from Kentucky to UT. I was there in the hospital with him when they had to put an IV in the baby's head because his arms were too small to put an IV. I was there in the time when they told John they weren't sure whether they were going to have to cut his baby's arm off in order to save his life. I was there. I remember putting it on Facebook and sharing it as many times as I could, telling everybody that would to pray for his baby. Over 20,000 people around the world that I know of on one share were praying for John's baby. And God gave them a miracle. But what about the woman who you and your husband are believing for a baby, and every time you get pregnant, you end up with a miscarriage? What about that? What about when your baby was laying in the hospital and he didn't make it? Did you let it rock your faith? Most of us would.
Amen.
Most of us would. So many people, listen to this. Just pay attention for just a minute to this. I got to go a little intricate. But most people, when something happens, even let's say in your marriage, something happens, you and your spouse have an issue, it rocks you for a moment, it shakes you, and then you say you're bouncing back from it, but the truth of the matter is you still got something on reserve from that situation. There's still something sitting on the inside of you about that situation. Am I making sense to anybody?
Right.
Let's say that spouse cheated and you decided to stay. You stay, but somewhere on the inside, you still deal with trust and unforgiveness, distrust and unforgiveness. Huh? I'm talking real talk here, right?
Amen.
This is stuff that really happens, right?
Amen.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, what happens when your faith gets shaken because God, for whatever reason, does not pull you out of your prison? It said these, let me bring you back to my text. It said after the song of Sunday and so on and so forth, he said, but they died in faith, not having yet received. All of their faith was building up to one thing. and Jesus and him crucified. They didn't even really know the fullness of it. They heard the prophecy, though the prophecy heard everything, but they all died. They were willing to get sawed in half with this God, and they had not even experienced the cross yet. Are y'all hearing me tonight? They were willing to die, and Jesus had not yet died for them. They went to the grave, and they still had not got the promise. What do you do? What do you do when he doesn't do it? At least not in the time that you think he's going to do it. What if his answer is not yet? Or what if his answer is no? The Lord said this to me. He said, I want you to tell the saints when you get there. He said, I need them to know. He said, if you can trust me in the moments where it looked like I didn't do it, you qualify yourself for the greater blessing when I do. Wow. If you keep walking with him with no reserve, contingency clauses. I'm trying to close this, y'all. Some of us have contingency clauses in our walk with God. We got that door, that one little door. And if this doesn't happen, if that doesn't happen, I'm out.
Amen.
And here's the bigger problem. Some of us aren't out physically. We still go through all the motions.
See, I told you, and it comes for just to make you feel good. We still go through the month. There's some people in here right now. The Lord said, there are people in here right now that in your walk with God, you tried to walk with him, and in some place, your faith has been shaken. And so when your faith got shaken, now, you still come to church. You still do church sometimes. You still sing songs. Can I tell y'all something? You can still feel the goosebumps. But you're missing the power. Your life is not marked with the power of God operating in it. Preacher. Everybody in this room. Did you say everybody? I said everybody in this room. You're, if you say, you serve the Lord. Your life should be marked with the power. And the movement of the Holy Ghost.
Oh, amen.
Shut up, us.
I'm not just talking because you can talk in tongues.
Come on.
I don't care if you talk in tongues or not.
Come on.
Is your life marked with the power of the Holy Ghost that when people come in contact with you who are broken, you can introduce them to a loving. I didn't say introduce them to your church. I said introduce them to a loving God who gave his son to die on the cross for them. Can you do that? Everybody in this room, if you say you serve the Lord, I'm going to sound crazy. No rhythm yet. No BPM. Stay right there where you were. Even mama, right here in this wheelchair. If mama loves the Lord, there's going to be power that resonates off of her life.
people. You know that? Have you ever been in a situation? I'm trying to quit, y'all, really am. Have you ever been in a situation where you walked in a room and somebody said, you know what? There's just something about you.
Come on.
We all know what it is about you. There's something about you.
Come on.
I was feeling down, but when you walked in the room and brought me some joy, I don't know what it is.
Yeah. Come on.
Oh, God. That's real Holy Ghost. That's the real Holy Ghost. When you don't have to say a word.
Hallelujah.
There's something sitting on the inside of you that every time you turn around, you can't be quiet. You can't hold your peace. I'm telling you, you'll think you just got a nap and you got short, but everything looks crazy.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Amen, brother. Amen.
Amen. Come on. Something in your something on the inside. Working.
On the
outside. We're changing your life. Change in my life. Change in the lives of people that are around us.
Hallelujah.
But that won't work if you have not gotten the resolve in your spirit. What if he doesn't do it? I ain't gonna be shaken. I'm not gonna be moved. Listen, these right here are connected to me. These two right here go to my church. That one there goes to my church. He travels with me, plays for me. Back in January, I went through one of the most devastating moments of my life. Can I be honest with y'all? I went through a pain that I did not understand. I thought for sure, I knew, not this thought, I knew for sure God had told me something. And then everything fell apart. And I had to deal with the pain. The pain was so heavy. Can I be honest with y'all? One night from 11:30 at night to 4:30 in the morning, I laid on my sofa. I cried and I was so hurt and so broken that I was literally shaking through my tears. It takes a lot to get me to that place. But I was there, Pastor James. Surely God had told me what he told me, and I knew it. And everything just fell completely to pieces. And I lay there broken. And the devil told me, while I laid there from 11:30 to 4:30, the devil told me, it ain't going to happen for you, ever. What you're trusting God for ain't going to happen for you, ever. I'll be honest, I had to wrestle from 11:30 to 4:30.
Come on.
Then I had to decide I was not going to stay in that condition.
Hallelujah.
I was going to serve.
Come on.
This God. Whether what I was expecting to happen happened or didn't happen.
Hallelujah.
Hello. Come on.
Yeah.
If I died and it didn't happen, I'd be just fine. If I die and it does happen, I'll be just fine. I had to resolve that no matter what, I was going to be just fine. I was going to keep on serving.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Tonight, hallelujah.
I'm done. I'm going to shut the video off. Tonight, saints of God, I had to deliver this message. I asked God, I said, God, why do I have to be the opener?